kickflip. It should be easy, the board flips only once, so why is it so difficult? What if I said it's in the logic of this track, not the amount of force? Intuitively, it seems you can effectively flip the board by applying a downward force to it as it comes up toward you, but your front foot will reach the ground first by doing so. They use various expressions to solve this problem, such as don't flick down and flick upward. However, many people struggle with this trick as their boards stick to their feet no matter how strongly they flick out their front feet. I can assure you that a kickflip is not about strength. What you should be doing, instead of forcing your front foot to give it a flick, is to direct your flick in the right direction by opening your front knee. Then, you can flip your board with the tiniest amount of force. In this video, we will analyze the motion of a kickflip physically and physiologically to reveal the secrets to flipping the board effectively. Don't worry, you will get your kickflip, and why the trick will support you in your kickflip journey. First, let's see what it takes to flip a skateboard. We'll call the red line connecting the nose and tail the x-axis. A board flips most efficiently when a perpendicular force applied to the x-axis. Of course, the actual force does not have to be perfectly vertical. It is important that the force contains enough perpendicular components to the x-axis when broken down. By now, you must have realized, if this is the only force that acts on the board, the tail won't lift and you'll wind up doing a rocket kickflip. So there is another force that has to work on the board. Now, let's call the line connecting the toe and heel the y-axis. Normally, in a kickflip, the board rotates around this y-axis as the front foot flicks the side of the nose, which is angled, dropping the nose and lifting the tail. In light of the amount of force the board needs to flip, as I said at the beginning of this video, it only takes around 300 to 400 grams at minimum. Based on these facts, the physical logic behind the board's flip is very simple, and generating the power to make it happen does not seem that difficult either. So, what makes a kickflip so hard? The answer lies in human physiological tendencies. Generally, we are accustomed to extending our lower legs forward and pushing them down as in walking. Therefore, in a sense, it is natural that you want to generate a perpendicular force on the x-axis by kicking down your front foot as the board rises toward you. The other motion we are accustomed to, extending the lower leg forward, is also tricky. If you extend your lower leg toward the toe, you will push and stagger the x-axis. As a result, you won't be able to generate a perpendicular force to the x-axis, and the board will only stick to your front foot without flipping. So, what should we do? The key is hiding in the common practice where you stand on the ground and flick the nose while holding the tail with your back foot. You must have felt flicking is easier in this practice. This is exactly where the secret of the kickflip lies. In this practice, your hip joint and knee are open, making it easier to control your lower leg horizontally without having to flick it down. Also, even when you extend your lower leg, your front foot does not interfere with the x-axis, allowing the force to escape to the side of the nose. In other words, it is important to have your front knee and hip joint open in order to flick your board effectively. Conversely, if the knee remains closed when flicking, you will have to push it diagonally downward. It makes it a lot harder to flip the board and will exacerbate a kicking down motion. Also, if you try to flip the board by extending your lower leg to avoid flicking down, the board will fly forward, or the board's axis of rotation will be off, causing a crooked kickflip. Next, Let's examine a kickflip chronologically and analyze how opening the front knee applies a perpendicular force to the x-axis. Starting from the beginning. Immediately after popping the tail, the nose begins to lift in an arc. The front foot slides up toward the side of the nose while the front knee opens up. The force acting on the nose pushes the front toe back, bringing it closer to the body's center of gravity. The force of the nose rises, gradually decreases, and the lower leg starts to rotate around the front knee as it tries to return to its original state from the position where it's pushed back and combines with the force of the flick. The front foot releases the force of the flick to the side of the nose since the front knee is open. The toe moves around the front knee in an arc, exerting a downward force on the board. Do you see what I mean now? Although the process of intentionally applying a downward force has never occurred in the sequence, but as a result, a downward force to the x-axis has been generated. We must be careful here. As the lower leg continues to rise throughout the flicking motion, the absolute position of the toe goes up almost constantly. However, if we focus on the rotation of the foot around the knee, we can see that the toe exerts a downward force at the moment of a flick, and changes the direction of travel upward after the flicking motion. This difference between the feeling and the actual physics that takes place is the answer to the paradox of applying a downward force by flicking upward. Furthermore, since the force escapes to the side of the nose, it only generates a perpendicular force to the x-axis and effectively flips the board without pushing or interfering with it. Please remember, all this results from opening the front knee. Keep in mind, it does not directly translate extending the lower leg is always evil. In a varial kickflip, for example, the board rotates in the direction of a pop shove-it, and you can flip the board by extending the lower leg forward. Good thing, no matter how hard you kick out your front foot, it will never interfere with the x-axis. In other words, there are two types of flicks. One generated by extending the lower leg, and the other by opening the front knee. And you have to choose which one to use depending on the trick you are attempting. Now, let's move on to see some other factors that you might want to consider. If the board doesn't flip properly even when you open your front knee, you may need to reconsider the timing. Let's go back in time again. Right after the pop, the board is nearly horizontal, and the entire front leg lifts rapidly. At this time, no matter how strongly you flick out your front foot, it only exerts a parallel force to the x-axis, and you cannot generate a rotational force on the board. As we all conceive the timing differently, some people say wait before flicking, while others say continue moving the front foot throughout the flicking motion. However, one thing that is common from a physics perspective is that the board flips more efficiently after the nose rises high enough. You can control the knee's angle not only by the timing, but also by the direction of the pop. For example, when I do a low kickflip, I pop the tail while pulling it harder. This pushes the front foot back harder, bending the front knee, and making it easier to create a stronger force to flick. A similar phenomenon can occur when wearing new shoes. Generally, they are stiffer and have more grip, so the front foot may stop halfway up the board and might not be able to slide all the way up to the nose. Adjust the pop's direction depending on the shoe's grip to control the angle of your knee and the position of your front foot. Finally, the way you use your upper body might also cause unexpected difficulty in flipping. If you are not used to kickflips, you might force lift your upper body unnecessarily high in an attempt to give the board as much airtime as possible. The problem is that the lower leg stretches downward in reaction, preventing the board from rising. In order to solve this problem, you need to relax your upper body, which is easier said than done. If you don't believe me, try doing a kickflip with your arms down, or even hands in your pockets. You should be able to flip your board way faster than usual. And that's all for this episode. It's finally getting warmer. Let's go skate. Be safe. Until next time.